What you are looking at is a Needle CPU, the Xeon 3-1245V3, a 10-year-old piece of tech that we are about to find out if it is enough to breathe life into a 4th-gen Intel Office PC from 2013. However, I must warn you that the final results might surprise you, regardless of how high or low your expectations might be. Unless you've been hiding underground playing with potatoes, you should already know that over the past few months, we've seen a flood of AAA games that are unreasonably CPU and GPU intensive than ever before, though they don't reciprocate any significant improvement in terms of graphics fidelity or in-game physics and AI. Still, they ask for more cores, more processor units, faster clocks, higher thread counts, large cores, up-to-date instruction sets, faster memory, sometimes are demanding more VRAM than your computer's total RAM, and to make matters worse, this trend is spreading to more and more PC games made mainly by big studios, and eventually will affect also the independent game developers. Compared with what it used to be, a few years old CPUs and graphics cards are becoming increasingly relevant by the software and gaming industry much faster than before. And PC components older than that, nowadays, are definitely struggling to keep up with the latest games even at lowest settings. Does this mean that folks with old computers have to give up all their entertainment dreams until they have the means to purchase a shiny new gaming rig? Or is there a way to squeeze a few more years out of their old but not obsolete tech? To answer that, I will use as an example this $30 Xeon i3-1245V3 processor unit with the hope to breathe new life into my oldie and neglected Haswell Office PC. Will this be enough of an upgrade to handle modern PC games in 2023 without annoying frame drops or stutters? And if it does the trick, how long can I expect this to keep up with today's gaming scene?
I'm extremely proud to show to you and expose to you the next generation of Intel Core technology, codenamed Haswell, which is going to be coming to the world next year.
Hi, it's Josh from Apt Electronics here at CES 2013. We're hanging out with Serhan at Intel, and we want to learn a little bit more about the Haswell processor in 2013 that's going to come out sometime soon.
Intel is coming out with a new chip. Its code name is Haswell. The chip is going to have an extended battery life and will power up in about 3 seconds.
The history behind Haswell processors might have faded from the collective memory, but certainly not from the minds of those well-versed in the realm of older PC hardware. This 4th-gen 22-nanometer architecture was launched by Intel 10 years ago, and it was the successor of the successfully EV Bridge. Sure, Haswell may not have been a giant leap in processing performance. However, it optimized features like energy efficiency and the integrated graphics unit, making it clear that Intel's main focus was the laptop and mobile market. On the other hand, desktop users had to settle with a modest 6-10% improvement in gaming performance and an awful heat dissipation caused by the new chipset design and the application of cheap thermal paste inside the CPU die. As far as the promising new iGPU blueprint, it could barely bring 5 extra frames to the table compared to what the previous units could, offering in most games of that era the unplayable average of 17 frames per second. Considering also the price tag of the desktop i7 Haswell CPU, selling out around $300 to $350 just to replace the trusty EV and Sandy Bridge processor, didn't make a lot of sense back then. On the flip side, for those who weren't particularly concerned about overclocking or unlocked features and had a keen eye for bargains, there was the option of the significantly cheaper Xeon variants that have similar characteristics to the locked Core i7 SKUs. It's rather surprising that even after a decade, the Haswell i7 CPUs continue to fetch inflated prices on the second-hand market, sometimes reaching levels compared to those of modern CPUs. What's more, even the locked 4th-gen Core i7 processors still carry a higher price tag compared to their Xeon counterparts, despite the latter offering similar performance. As a matter of fact, today you can buy for less than $30 this Intel Xeon i3-1245V3, which has exactly the same specifications as the i7-4770. Expect the slightly slower turbo speed. Best part is that there are also two Xeon variants without integrated graphics processor unit that cost only a jackson each. A purchase like this could bring life to an old Haswell system by replacing any Core i3 or i5 processor. As such, it was imperative to test this theory and determine once and for all whether or not this inexpensive upgrade will be sufficient to support my gaming ventures in 2023. So, I went ahead and bought a used Xeon i3-1245V3, I paired it up with an ASUS Z97E motherboard and a beefy double fan air cooler. Overkill, I know, but why the heck not? I also threw in two memory sticks of total 16GB RAM running at 2400 megatransfers per second and power up all this with a 700W PSU. Finally, I opted for an M.2 NVMe device to house Windows 10, the games, and all the other necessary software. Obviously, this is not your typical Intel 4th Gen Office PC. The idea behind this setup was to eliminate any potential bottlenecks that could hinder the performance of our CPU. For the same reason, I tried to install my best graphics card, an RTX 2070.
You serious?
You dare ya! Sure, this doesn't count as a high-tier card in 2013, but it is what I have right now, and for my purpose I thought this would be more than enough. Alas, the best laid plans of hardware and men often go awry. The RTX card was indeed more than enough for the PC case to host the GPU inside, so I had to select my second best GPU, a GTX 1660 Super. Will this be sufficient to get a true sense of our Xeon's capabilities? Was yet to be seen. The games of the current benchmarking suite are picked based on two main criteria. Firstly, they had to be CPU intensive and somewhat modern. Secondly, they had to be popular with an active player base, ensuring that the final results would resonate to a wide audience and be relevant to the gaming scene. With that in mind, I equipped my benchmarking suite with 4 AAA titles, 2 widely known Battle Royale games, and 1 game that will tear down any CPU that you can think of. I also throw in a few synthetic benchmarks for comparison reasons, along with some interesting emulation footage in case you are curious to know how this old i3-1245 Xeon is doing in tasks beyond the field of standard PC gaming. Since the GTX 1660 Super can't quite handle 100% all the AAA titles at high resolution and high settings, I execute all of my tests at 1080p, with exception the first game in our list that I ran it at 1440. Rest assured, Valorant has very low system requirements, thus it can run on a SPAD. This is why I'm making it the bare minimum that a CPU should meet. If a CPU can't handle this, then it belongs to the realm of old and obsolete tech. The opposite of my channel, obviously. So I tried running Valorant on our i3-1245V3 at 1440 resolution, playing with all the different presets. I said I tried. I succeeded in testing only the medium preset settings, where the overall performance of our Xeon was fine, if you don't count, of course, the rough start or the distinct CPU bottleneck. Unfortunately, the rest of the preset settings will remain unexplored. Playing this game for the first time, I didn't expect to stumble upon so many obstacles. First off, I ran into this weird bug where my mouse wasn't lined up with the menu buttons. I had to use my third eye just to get into my first match. And even then, the game pulled a fast one on me and locked at 119 frames per second, even though I had it set to unlimited. So that was the straw that broke Valorant's back, just in time for our next Battle Royale champion. Fortnite has been quite heavier in the past few years, especially since they switched over to Unreal Engine 5. With consequence, our Xeon ended up struggling when testing in DirectX 12 or DirectX 11 modes, causing some serious frame drops and a huge difference between the average and 1% lows. No matter what quality settings I tried or which options I played around with, the end result was always the same. I did everything I could to get rid of these annoying hitting issues, using some tricks that have worked wonders in similar situations in the past. However, this time it could only lessen the problem and not by much. I would love to put the blame on Fortnite, or even my lack of troubleshooting skills. However, the layout of MSI Afterburner was telling a different story, showcasing an obvious CPU bottleneck, and probably the true culprit for this shaky situation. So, I decided to set all of my hopes on the less handsome but snappier performance mode. For a moment, I was worried that this would be my first 4-core 8-thread CPU that wouldn't be able to handle Fortnite. And fortunately, the choppy frame rates got way better, and I was finally able to enjoy playing, more spectating than anything else, but still, considering all the above, even this felt like a pretty sweet victory to me. We haven't even yet hit the hard part of our trials, and our Xeon CPU is already in trouble. I mean, if it can even handle the easy stuff with ease, how it's gonna get through the big guns? Well, the demo of Resident Evil 4, the remake, might be able to shed some light into this. Running the game at 1080p and all the recommended settings from Digital Foundry and Benchmarking, things got off to a bit of a rocky start, but luckily it smoothed out after a few seconds. It looks like that 55 frames per second is a natural cap, which is totally fine for this type of action games. Actually, the CPU wasn't even breaking a sweat most of the time, and it gave pretty solid performance. Dropping all the settings to minimum caused some CPU bottlenecks here and there, but it also increased the overall frames per second, which is a pretty good trade-off if you ask me. Cyberpunk 2077 is another notoriously demanding game. To make matters worse, according to recent news, the game's system requirements will soon be increased to absurd levels. Regardless of that, and just before the death of the low-spec gamer, our 10-year-old Xeon managed to pull out 73 on average and 48 1% lows while running the in-game benchmark at 1080p high preset settings with FSR 2.0 set to quality. Jesus. Pretty wild, eh? If this wasn't enough to get you skeptical, with low ray tracing enabled, the FPS meter records 72 average and 46 1% lows. Yeah, right. So I decided to ditch the built-in benchmark and do some actual gameplay testing. And guess what? The benchmark was totally lying. What a sum! Checking this time the new results with the high 60s on average and 1% lows barely above 40 FPS in the low preset, things sound a bit more normal. I did manage to boost the 1% lows by 15% by turning on the HDD feature and reducing the crowd density, which helped to smooth out the frame time. And the good news is, even at native 1080p low settings, the game still looks pretty darn good. The downside is, if you lock the frames at the level of 1% lows, your gameplay will get a little laggy. That being said, I don't think this will throw your gameplay experience out of whack.
Just fuck off, please!
Unless if you take it personally. Elden Ring was yet another game that put our Xeon processor through the ringer. Despite it did pretty well while the in-game character remained inside shady dungeons and closed spaces, the second he stepped out into an open area or faced for the first time water reflections, things got really shaky. Moreover, at 1080p low settings, the frame rate could barely stay above the mid-30s under dramatic scenes. On the flip side, even at max settings, the frame rate rarely dropped below 30 FPS. So it's a kind of a glass half full or half empty situation. If you desire a constant 60 frames per second, your hopes will be definitely sliced into pieces. Less punishing was God of War Rag.
You hear that, Doug? I'm coming to London! Timothy! Shut up and sit down, you big bald fuck.
I am and God of War, full stop, was the only game that video capture was acting up. So let me change the scene and spare you from spontaneous seizures. Ah, that's better. Now, looking at the numbers, it turns out God of War was most limited by GPU across all presets, which is pretty interesting. It is also the only AAA title in our benchmarking suite that nailed the console-level image quality at 60fps. Almost 60fps. Finally, and as I promised, I left for last the new addition in my game library. Its title is Tear Down, a stupidly fun to play voxel-based game where you get to wreak havoc and completely demolish everything inside. And don't let the blocky graphics fool you, this game is seriously demanding for any kind of gaming rig, old or new. Specifically, our Xeon 1245V3 was straight up weeping during gameplay. It didn't matter what preset setting I chose. Whenever the screen was filled with distraction and house, the GPU usage would drop down to 50% and the FPS tanked hard, causing major slowdowns. As for the game itself, I consider it as one of the most entertaining tools I ever used to bully a CPU. Let me know if you like to watch more videos featuring Teardown as a part of my CPU benchmark suite. Overall, the Xeon i3 1245V3 didn't pull out all the stops with sky-high frames per second and smooth frame times. On the other hand, it didn't disappoint it either. At least in theory, it is able to run every modern PC game out there. And in fact, it can, if you lower your expectations below the psychological barrier of native 1080 resolution 60fps. Beyond that, it is an excellent CPU for everyday applications, office tasks, web browsing, and even media-related activities. Considering the fact that it consumes a maximum of 50 watts and remains cool under some very demanding tasks, it is an ideal choice to build with inexpensive small form factor systems. On top of that, you can create an amazing retro gaming setup using the CPU. It is capable of handling demanding emulators like Dolphin, allowing you to dive into Wii games like New Super Mario Bros. If you are more into timeless PlayStation 3 games, you can rely on that the RPCS 3 will run like a charm. And if you are a Microsoft fan, you can even install and run the XEMU to play some classic Xbox titles. Of course, you know what they say, the larger your ROM size, the longer the loading times. This Xeon is a decade old, so don't expect miracles. If you are working with a tight budget and you are stuck with a 4th generation Intel Core i3 or i5 office PC, then upgrading into a Xeon i3 1245V3 can make a significant difference. However, if your goal is to play the latest and greatest PC games, it's time to start saving money, like yesterday, because the time of this old Xeon and its Haswell platform has already run out. I will appreciate any feedback and encourage you to share your thoughts about this video. Feel free to explore my YouTube channel for more awesome old but not obsolete tech content. Meanwhile, don't forget to hit the like button if you like, subscribe if you haven't done so already, and turn on the notifications so you don't miss any future video. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one!